Good afternoon and a huge welcome to BLOXHUB. My name is Pernille Berg and I am more than delighted to welcome you to today's grand finale of our fall event series designing the Irresistible Circular Society, which is coming to an end. Across the series, we've been enlightened by a myriad of trailblazing researchers and a variety of pivotal subjects regarding the future of societal circularity. We've also had eminent companies and speakers that have helped us in answering the questions that we started out with in the very beginning, namely, how do we ensure a sustainable future? And how will our buildings and cities be created and by whom? This could not be done without our wonderful partners who have helped me and my colleagues with designing this event series. A huge thanks to Aarup 3XN, GXN, Lennar Group, the Royal Academy, Danish Design Center, Build from Aalborg University. Just a little bit about where we are today. We are broadcasting live from Copenhagen, so it's afternoon in Denmark at the moment. It may be morning or evening wherever you are, and we're delighted to have you with us. BLOXHUB was founded in 2018 as an initiative to create a space where collaboration and partnerships between companies, organizations, researchers, and practitioners can emerge. We're about 700 research institutions, organizations, and companies who share our lives in BLOXHUB either as residents or members. The thriving community can be seen in new research projects, networks forming, partnerships emerging, and also product development. This series is also a testament to the wonderful members that BLOXHUB has. A huge welcome to you. We believe that new sustainable solutions regarding urban development come from collaborations, and that is why I'm delighted to have you with us here today, and also to welcome the speakers later, which will actually be done by Cole, who is our moderator today. We also have a few practical comments. Today we have Rikke as your chat hostess, and we also have you with us. Stay on this link, on this line, as it were. We'll have a brief break at some point so that you can refresh coffee cups or whatever you have as refreshments. But without further ado, what is next for the circular economy, how digitization and finance can accelerate this transition is what we are dealing with today. And Cole, thank you for helping me and the partnership in orchestrating today's grand finale of Science Talk and Debate. It is such a delight, and now to let you take over from here. Thank you, and enjoy.
Thank you, Pernille, and thank you for this opportunity. So, what is next for the circular economy? That's the question we're asking with this Science Talk and Debate. The reason we chose this question for the ultimate Science Talk and BLOXHUB Debate this year was that we've seen so many great solutions, so many great perspectives from researchers. I think we've proven now and seen proven again and again by the industry, by the researchers, that we can do circular construction, that circular economy can be implemented in the built environment. But we are still facing the problem of how to scale a circular economy. How do we take these one-off solutions, these great ideas, these pieces of research that we see, and really make sure that they come into the built environment as a whole, scale through and bring value for the whole value chain and for a much larger segment of investors, building owners, developers, companies, and of course, building users. So this question of how do we scale, how do we bring the circular economy to the next step is what we're going to be debating here. We're going to be talking about two of the things that we can use to scale things, namely technology and money. That is the subsection of this debate, how digitization and finance can accelerate the transition to circular economy in the built environment. So stick around. We're going to have a great debate in about half an hour from now. We'll have a short break just before the debate, so don't go anywhere. But before the debate, I'm very happy to be able to introduce to you now Jarl Engelbreit Winders. Jarl is the founder and CEO of Stykke. Stykke is a Copenhagen-based startup working with bringing digital technologies to design and fabrication. Jarl is going to tell us a lot more about what that means, help set us up for a good debate afterwards. So please, Jarl, welcome. Thank you so much for taking part in this. And please tell us what you're doing at Stykke.
Great. Well, thank you, Cole. I'm super excited to be here and share with you kind of the work we do at Stykke and also a bit of trivia and our views of the world and how we approach circularity in what we do. So I'm starting out with posing an interesting question to me, that this is one of the profound things we need to really answer for. Can the construction industry actually be part of the solution to kind of the global threats of climate change? This is what we ask ourselves when we go to work, and this is actually a driving factor in designing the systems we build. So I'm just going to share a bit of trivia first. So, and first piece of trivia is 90% of all materials we harvest and mine on this planet is single use only. And this is a bit of a problem to me. But also, our construction sector, our sector here, accounts for more than 40% of all emissions. And also, we generate a ton of waste on all the landfills all over the world. To us, this is a bit of a problem that we need to solve. We need to fix the way we work and to adapt technology to do better. And this is exactly what we try to build. So when we look at greenhouse gas emissions, I'm just going to put a graph up here. And this is, I don't know about you guys, but this is, to me, slightly depressing. This is a really beautiful exponential curve. And to me, this is one of the biggest threats to our ways of living. So we really need to do something right now about this stuff. And we have a lot of politicians talking about flatlining the curve. And to us, this is simply not good enough. We already have a huge debt we need to pay back in order to stabilize the ecosystems. So this is exactly what we set out to do. We are trying to develop simple tools that can help the construction industry to actually solve the climate crisis and potentially better the planet. So how do we do this at scale, and where do we start? So we have two main things we work with. One is wood. Wood is the perfect medium for sequestering and storing carbon. But also technology is a hugely important factor in actually making a scalable system. So the raw materials we use, we mainly use FSC 100 certified plywood. We try to source the most responsible materials we can get on the planet. And we work with FSC certified sub-suppliers that are pretty good at maintaining forest and planting new forest as they harvest. There are many issues with this. Clear cutting is a thing we really need to be careful with, but also the way we manage this, and also the way that the increasing demands from the construction sector going forward is going to impact forestry globally is also a thing. But one thing for us is pretty sure: we need to replace concrete with wood at scale. So carbon capture is pretty efficient. When you plant trees, they suck carbon out. The trick here is to store all the sequestered carbon in good products. So we need to stop using melamine facing chipboard and these expensive materials that can't really be replaced and repaired. So for us, we mainly work with really high density plywood, stuff like this. And the trick here is to make sure that all the sequestered CO2 never gets turned back into a gas shape. It needs to stay sequestered inside the material. This is why we need to build this circular loop where we keep track of all the grams we have out there in the building industry. So the stuff we built is a design tool that helps our designers quickly design products that are beautiful, simple, and designed for disassembly. We made some pretty cool design tools that help designers make all the right choices when they design. They can optimize for material use and carbon sequestering and all that stuff. But also, we built a network of factories that attach to our platform. So making new furniture is as easy as pressing Control P. And we built the whole network asset lights in order for us to scale fast and scale globally. Also, we have this feature where since every piece of furniture is designed with algorithms, we can actually save all the recipes for the furniture in the cloud. So we do this in order to be able to maintain parts and bits and pieces. And actually, the concept of working with digital twins is a part of the network, and that's a part of kind of the most important things in actually making a system that works. So the core concept here is to go from a highly fragmented building industry where we have a ton of information loss into this digital twin-born solution where we can, along with the end client, sketch the furniture and have real insights into cost and optimizations, and also just manufacturing from this initial set of drawings. And also the same drawings can then be put into the operation side of things. This is where we actually harvest some of the really large benefits from this way of working. So we started out in 2019, where we did the first 1,000 housing units quite successfully. And now we've added more than 6,500 more houses to the pipeline in the past, in the coming 3 years. So we're seeing a huge uptake from the market. So we're trying to approach the built-in environmental industry. We do interiors for large-scale construction projects. And we are about to release the first product in the beginning of next year. I'm going to share with you guys a little sneak peek. We call it the Digital Carpenter's Kitchen, where we used our tech platform to solve an actual problem that's kitchens, for example. It's hugely wasteful when we build. So normally a house, a large-scale construction project is built to last 100 years, but everything we generate and put inside the building has a life expectancy of around 10 years. And to us, this is a huge missed opportunity. And this is where we put our technology to use. So the value we bring to the projects is we make high-quality products at pretty reasonable prices, because everything is costed with algorithms from us. You don't buy a kitchen, but you buy a cloud of parts that fit together to form a product. And once you remove the product out of the equation, you actually get a hugely efficient cost structure that enables you to get really high quality for a reasonable cost. So everything we do is made so it can be maintained and repaired. And the kitchen, as we envision it here, is a very minimalistic, simple Scandinavian kitchen, but it's made from the best possible materials. Everything is solid wood, linoleum, and we can actually very cost-efficiently produce it at scale. So one of the core concepts here is we greatly reduce the amount of parts, make something that's very simple, and this is ground up, built to be repaired. So this means we could start really optimizing all the material use throughout the product, and also greatly reducing the amount of parts, but also everything is made with high-quality connectors that enables us to be able to take the kitchen apart again after it's been installed. And this is one of the keys into making products that can last a really long time, is the ability to just repair them when they break. So to us, this is a key factor in good design, design for disassembly. Also, since you design everything to be taken apart and refurbished, we can also start upgrading in the future. So for one of the large housing projects we're working with a front end where users can actually come in, and in time, they can access a digital twin from a 3D model and in essence order new fronts for their existing kitchens. And since we have QR codes and computer chips on all the wooden pieces we supply for the kitchen, we can actually do a full circular take-back model for the kitchens. This means that when you have a new tenant moving in, we can allow the tenant to go to the 3D model, exchange the fronts, order new, and we can take the old parts back because we keep track of all the bits. So again, this is all attributed to this digital data structure we have behind every project, where we keep track of all the parts, and also this allows us to build a facility management platform against both user and the facility managers for the projects. So in every housing unit, you have QR codes in all the kitchens where you can access a full 3D model. This allows you to quickly just click the parts that break. You don't need to know anything about versioning. And the great thing is, since the system is just a recipe for the parts that break, we don't run into problems where things go out of production, because we always have a network of factories that are ready to make all the parts again. I'm just going to share a little video of how this works. It works simply by scanning. You don't need an app to do this, but it enables you to just quickly see the project, see all the parts, drill down and find the part that's broken. And the great thing here is, as we get more and more users on board, we actually start learning what breaks, where does stuff break, who reports, and so on. So in a very simplistic way, this data set is correlated to the exact parts, and this provides us with a hugely meaningful data set in how to optimize going forward. So the ability to extract data paired with the physical parts is a very valuable source. We also share this with all the clients. So the overarching goal here is to minimize waste and learn and do better as we progress in time. So one thing is upgrading your looks and feels for your kitchen, but also we are partnering with a set of really interesting companies, Philips, Cooker, to name a few. They do plugins and things where we enable the users to actually be able to functionally upgrade their products in time. So this is also one of the relevant things you need to be able to do is to functionally keep your product relevant. So once you have the digital twin system going, it's actually easy because we can always contextualize versioning. And this enables us to very informed let users to actually upgrade their individual products. So the whole idea of the kitchen is we see this as a carbon sink principle. We're working with some of the leading scientists at DTU in order to figure out how to optimize and maximize the amount of carbon we store in the kitchen. So we're still working on the actual numbers, but we hope to be able to prove that this kitchen is out of the box CO2 negative. But also the thing here is this is made to last a long time. So the ability to repair in time theoretically saves a lot of waste going forward where you should normally scrap a kitchen every 10 years. So another large housing projects we're starting up in this next year. We've been doing some math and we can just see that we can, in this one full project, we can capture as much as 750 tons of carbon CO2 equivalents in a single housing project. And the trick here is to, instead of throwing parts out when they break. An average life expectancy for a kitchen in Denmark is around 10 years. So if we can, in theory, save someone from throwing parts out in 10 years, this will have a profound effect going forward, the ability to just put parts back into a circular loop. Here is a small video from one of our suppliers. We worked with every single one of our suppliers in actually trying to optimize the whole process of doing take-backs. So we have, again, as I've mentioned, codes and chips on every part. That means we can track changes, but also we can put it back into a system. And since everything is not melamine facing chipboard, but solid wood, this is actually repairable in the future. So when you scratch a surface, instead of just scrapping it, we can take it back and reapply a new surface coating or a new linoleum layer on it. Right now, it's not 100% comparable to making new parts. It's more expensive, but as we get more scale, we can see that this should actually be very doable in the very near future. So around next second half of 2022, we hope to be cost neutral in actually doing a full circular take back on fronts for kitchens. So what we really try to optimize for here is to create value for our users, and our customers are normally large pension trust funds and professional developers, where total cost of ownership is a very important thing. So normally in the construction industry, you go for cheapest, but if you are in the business of actually running things, you want total cost of ownership to be as low as possible in time, because this is where you really create value with your assets. So we're working with an open model for a total cost of ownership calculations that we're sharing with our customers. We're trying to perfect the model. And the core concept here is to show that sustainable can actually be cheaper than the polluting alternatives. So here I have a small graph we're working with where we, I don't hope you can see it on the webcast, but in essence, these graphs is our calculations for how normal products versus sustainable products. Sustainable products are a little bit more expensive up front, but when you factor in the amount of waste and the amount of units, we actually end up with a model where we can see we, with the initial higher investment up front, actually ends up being giving a pretty good return of investment. And we can see in an average size projects with 1,800 housing units, we have a huge saving. But the real kicker for me is the amount of materials we save here in time. So potentially we save just in one housing project over 1 million kilograms of kitchen waste, because everything we save every year just has a compounding effect in the future. So again, a few images of the kitchen, and we're super excited to launch this in the beginning of next year. And we hope this product will do great, because the more we install, the more impact we'll have as a company. So that was a bit on our story. Thank you.
Okay. Well, thank you so much, Jarl. I have a ton of questions. Some of them we'll bring into the debate, but I'm sure people out on behind the screens might also have some questions. So if you do have questions, please enter them into the chat and Pernille will bring them to us. This goes for now, but also for the debate. But I have a question on one of the things you were saying, which struck me as interesting, but I maybe didn't get it fully. Is I think you said once you take the product out of the equation, the physical product, you get a more efficient cost structure. That sounds amazing, but could you elaborate a little bit on that and how that happens and what that means?
Yes. Normally, when you do a large-scale housing project, you make a huge PDF. You send out for quotation at different subcontractors. And when you're confronted with a 200-page PDF and ask how much will this cost, well, the thing is, people smile at you and they say, I'm happy to calculate a cost for you. But in reality, you don't really have any tools to help you decipher this huge amount of material you need to design. Because when you are given like 200 apartments, this is a loosely described concept. And people like that uncertainty in that equation, well, normally you just add a bit of buffer in order to save, save yourself some of the potential fuck-ups while pricing. So what we do here is the math we developed, we can actually break the full product or the full project down because we have the whole building in 3D, all the parts. We actually cost calculate every single part of the project down to the millisecond of actual manufacturing cost. That just gives us great insight into the most material optimizations we can tweak out of it. So we actually do a bottom-up calculation of all the parts, and that actually enables us to really cost-efficiently purchase materials. And that, again, allows us to be able to afford otherwise way too expensive materials in mundane things like a small kitchen. So the ability to do a solid wood kitchen that is IKEA price plus 30 is what this tech can do.
So if I understand this right, it's having a finer granularity on the data or information available that allows you to be able to go out and be more precise when you are procuring and getting materials in. That gives you a better chance to control costs.
Exactly.
Okay, that's amazing. Well, there's more questions. With the digital twin, so because you have this data, it's all the way there. You give birth to the kitchen, so to say, with the digital twin. That enables take back for you. So I'm wondering a little bit in terms of you're thinking about scaling this. So as I understand it, this is something you can do in principle. You're exploring it for the kitchen fronts. But is this something you want to be scaling up for the full kitchen? And what are you going to be doing with the materials and what are the challenges that you're facing there?
Yeah, I mean, one of the core challenges at the moment is getting one single front at a time. So we need to be able to, shipping cost is, CO2-wise, shipping one front at a time is not as efficient unless we go through normal postal system. But what we try to do for the projects is to make a local buffer storage where we can, once we have 100 fronts at a time at the local buffer storage unit, we can do a full take back on the 100 fronts. So for now, doing a single front where you reset it, you reapply a new surface, is not cost efficient enough. So we need a bit of scale. So for now, the sweet spot seems to be at least 200 kitchen fronts at a time is what we need minimally to be processed in order to keep the costs efficiently. So, but in time, we hope to be able to automate the processes of taking skin off and reapplying skin. So it's all about, I think the key here is automation of those processes. We haven't gotten to those yet.
Sure. So you're working on it as you go. And is there a... the system you're developing on these kitchens, which is a great case also due to the... It's a shorter lifespan of these kitchens. I mean, fit-outs in general can be up to as much, have as much embodied carbon as the building itself because you're changing that often. So I'm wondering if you, this methodology that you've developed here, you think about scaling that to other parts of buildings or other types of interiors, or are there other projects in the works here?
It's a really good question, Cole. For now, we started with the kitchens because every home in this country has a kitchen. So it's a natural place to start. But I think the imagination kind of, we can set your imagination free. Like every piece of built-in furniture in a building could potentially be done in this way. It's quite efficient. So it can be used in many sectors, just housing units, but also hospitals and schools where you have a high degree of wear and tear. So that's naturally. But also, there's an interesting possibility of scaling this up into the way you actually construct the building. But that could be a separate project, I think.
Okay, so start with something for manageable.
Now. Yeah, everything we inside the building for now. This. Yeah.
Okay, and before we go with this, a question online.
Hi, we have two questions, and then I'll just read them out. There's one from Anas from, I think, Municipality of Copenhagen, saying hello. Thank you very much. It's really, really interesting. And the question is, do you have any possibility of scaling your concept, for example, partition walls? So that's the question from Anas. Then we have from Yule Mass, and thank you very much. Are there plans to target student accommodations or living situations with high occupant turnover?
Well, to start with Anas's question, well, potentially it ties into a course question from a second ago. Potentially we construct the full kitchens and everything in this way. So we've tested the ability to take the technology and actually do the room around the kitchen, and this scales very nicely into also room scale furniture. So you could potentially do partition walls quite efficiently in the same way, and also making sure we work in a modular fashion could also be one of the cores in making this work. But to move on to the other question, we actually started doing student housing projects where again, high turnover cases is super interesting because there is a lot of wear and tear. What we need is for stuff to wear fast in order to learn where to optimize. We started exactly there, and there are huge possibilities for optimizations there. So we are already working in that space with at least two of our clients already.
And one of them is here today and going to join the debate later on. So I think we will thank you once again, Jarl, for this great presentation and a great way to start this combined science talk and BLOXHUB debate. We will be going for 10 minutes, we say 10 minutes, and then we'll come back with a debate and a full panel of speakers to further debate this. So thank you all. Please stay on the line and see you in 10 minutes. Welcome back to this combined science talk and BLOXHUB debate. The question is, what is next for the circular economy? The theme is how digitization and finance can accelerate the transition to circular design and construction. We've just heard a great science talk from Jarl Engelbrecht Windles, the founder and CEO of Stücke. And we're now moving on to the debate part of the program. We have here in the studio now a distinguished set of speakers. In order of appearance, to my left, we have Niels Christian Jone, who is head of transactions at Pension Denmark, a large pension fund and real estate developer here in Denmark. We have Rolf Buchmann Slorup, who is a managing director and chief operating officer at HD Lab, a Danish startup bringing technology to construction and the built environment. And we have Jarl, CEO and founder of Stücke. And then we have Josien Pick with us from the Netherlands. Josien is partner of Haven Green Capital Partners. So in the next hour or so, we will be debating this question of how digitization and finance can accelerate the transition to circular, to more circular design and construction. Please remember that you can ask questions along the way. If you put your questions into the comments box, Pernille here in the studio will read them out as we go along. But to start things up, I would like to turn to you, Niels. So we just heard a great presentation from Jarl, from Stücke, explaining all the potential, all the great stuff that they can be doing, can do with technology, with digitization. And I know that you and Pension Denmark has gone into a collaboration with Stücke, and you have a project together. So I would like for you maybe to give us a little bit of a behind-the-scenes look and tell us what actually happens once you start working with Stücke. And if you could talk a little bit about your expectations going in, and what you learned along the way, that would be great.
Yeah, well, we 5 years ago, we started to develop our student housing concept, and together with DTU, the Technical University of Copenhagen. And there we were quickly faced with the problem of many foreign students having no furniture, and it identified that the Danish students didn't have furniture as well, or they would only use this furniture for a brief period. So we thought about how could we incorporate furniture into the student housing. And we were then confronted with the high capex and would things go out of production. And we came upon Stuka and found that concept extremely interesting. And together with them, we developed a built-in bed and storage furniture that could last for many years. So we looked, like I said, at an initial cost was a bit more, but on the long run, our capex would be lower. We expect it to be. The first project was taken into use, I think, 6 months ago. So we and the furniture has been met with great enthusiasm. And I think one of the important things that Jarl didn't mention is the high quality of the product, which means that we can actually we'll be able to generate more rent and more value for our customers, the tenants, which I think is very important to, and I think that's where the technology and the sustainability actually work with us as an investor to create a better product, not only a more environmentally sound product, but also a better product. I think it's been a very good collaboration, and we are looking forward to working more with Stuka on other furniture. We think this can develop a trend in all our buildings that we can diversify from other competitors in not only an environmental profile, but also to generate more value for the tenants.
Okay. So maybe just as a follow-up, I would like to take that last sentence you said in terms of generating more value for tenants, and I would imagine for Pension Denmark then. So could you elaborate a little bit on that point? You know, how can a project like this or projects like these generate value for you? And how is that sort of shift towards higher quality, longer life expectancies of your materials, maybe a more circular economy, how is that part of that value equation? Or how does it become a part? Is it a part or can it become a part?
It is a part. More quality just in one piece of furniture doesn't have to be in the whole, as an investor speaking, not as an environmentalist speaking, but as an investor speaking, just having some parts of the properties being of high quality and value generates a feeling for each tenant that the whole project is of value. So it's a good way to make signature pieces that diversify from other products. So it makes very much sense. Also, the environmental part of it generates not only a good image, but doing the part for us to get the targets on the environmental issues that we want and are obligated to meet in order to make the right investment.
Okay, so if we think about these targets a little bit, I'd like to bring Josi into the conversation. So when we were prepping this talk and we were having a conversation about some of the perspectives in these questions we're asking today, you said that you see a change or feel that we need a change in real estate investment from a system where we do value maximization, so looking at one parameter, to in one of a system where we're looking about optimization across multiple variables. And maybe this is what we heard about as an example of that. But I would like to ask you to elaborate on that, please, for us and explain what you're thinking about there.
Great, Kara. Thank you. What I want to say, and first of all, you know, I really like the presentation from Jarl. I thought he started off so well, you know, really showing that we are on a pathway which is leading to capital destruction in the end. So we're from a capitalist perspective, we want to make sure that we, you know, increase value and increase capital, but with the climate change problem and, you know, the ecological degradation that is just behind that, we are actually on a capital destruction path if we look out, you know, 5, 10 or maybe 15 years. We don't know exactly how long we still have, but it's not long. So clearly things need to change quite significantly. And it's beautiful to see, you know, innovation happening and collaboration and creativity. That's exactly what we need. But it's also important to see that there is still something really holding us back from making that big shift towards a more sustainable world. And And one of it is the fact that the way we've set up capitalism right now is that we focus on one variable, which is money. And we say, well, if we maximize money throughout the chain, we're doing a good job. But actually, if we, and the European Union is clearly on this path as well, there are other variables that are super important. Take carbon, but also energy, which are highly related, of course, water and waste. Those are the environmental sides. Then we still also have, you know, all the human stuff. We want to make sure that things are more diverse, that they're more fair, so there are other critical variables that are now being put into the equation, both by the investors themselves. And Pension Denmark is a great example of an investor doing that for a very long time and, you know, being very, very forward looking with these variables that are coming in, but also, of course, from the legislator. So the regulation and the EU regulation is then the most going furthest, is really saying, guys, we're going to have to not go from this one variable maximization equation to a multivariable optimization equation. We have to start making sure that we take these other variables into account. And I think that shift is so important to see that is without either a regulator or ourselves taking the other variables more seriously, it's going to be a very hard thing to try to make everything, put everything back to the money side of things. Even though I really, what I also very much liked about Jarl's approach was the fact that he added the open cost calculation to it, because that actually, that transparency of that ecological transparency and that financial transparency, in my view, they go hand in hand. We're coming to the position that the collective problems are so big that this transparency can help us move more quickly in the right direction together.
Okay, a lot of perspectives there, Josien. Thank you very much. But I like I like this notion of optimizing across a number of variables to try and get further with the transition and look at value in a more holistic way. But I would like to ask Nils, from where you're sitting as an investor, as a developer, is that something that you can recognize in your day-to-day practice?
Oh yeah, indeed. And I think I agree very much. We need to think about other variables, and that's why the quality is a part of that. The diversity, the way of living. I think it cooperates well with many parts of the investment, not on the sort of say on the cost side, but on generating top line. I know this back to the money, but it's difficult to stay away with that. But we do in all our calculation, we work with a carbon side and a cost side, so when a contractor suggests a reduction in cost, they have to show that it's not. Doesn't cost more on a carbon side. So we already work with several options, and we work with the social values as well, being who we are. We are owned by the building construction workers, so it is important to us that they have a good working environment as well. But generating more value on different parameters and thinking long term, I think is very important. And I also want to say that generating less waste is extremely important as well. I think the way technology should move forward is in reducing production. If we can, and that's exactly what Stücke does, reducing production, so we don't have a big stock of things that we can't use.
Sure. Thank you, Nils. So that question of technology and the promises and potential pitfalls of technology, I think, is quite interesting to take up now. So maybe, Rolf, if I could turn to you. You are managing a technology startup in the construction sector. Could you tell us a little bit about why you have created this startup and what value you can bring for your clients, what type of work you do?
Sure. Well, HT Lab was founded based on a idea that technology could aid some of these processes that going on in our industry and help us face some of the big problems, and circular construction being one of them, obviously. So currently we work on a lot of normal, if you dare to say so, normal construction projects in large scale, working with integrating the value chain, in doing a lot of digital scanning, working with ICT, working with digital collaboration, making sure that risk is reduced and profit is maximized, and we make fewer mistakes, etc. So that's kind of our starting point, working to face some of the challenges of our projects, de-risking the projects, making sure that the entire value chain is actually helped through technology. Yeah.
Okay, so that notion of integrating the value chain, I think, is very important for the circular economy. We all hold at our different companies a piece of the puzzle, and if we want to put those pieces together in new ways, we need to be more collaborative. We need to find new ways of collaborating, and for you, technology is one of the measures there.
Yeah.
Could you elaborate a bit on how that's going on? I'm thinking maybe also on the Circle Bank project that you guys are
part of. Yeah, so what Core is referring to is we are a part of an industrial research project called the Circle Bank and project. It's a project that has participants from a long range of different types of companies, architects, demolishing companies, investors, universities, etc. So the idea, the vision of that project is to answer the question of how do we ensure that we build a value chain that's based on circularity that can outcompete kind of the linear way of working. So that is the main thought of it. And what we're trying to achieve is actually creating a kind of a value chain that's so efficient and where we kind of remove all obstacles so we can actually scale circular construction. Try to prove, be the first to actually find the way through that major challenge that comprises of. So it's addressing everything from how do we efficiently, cost-effective and register building components for reuse? How do we ensure that it's tapped into how our demolishing companies work? How do we ensure that the quality, that we actually can reuse these components? How do we label them so they can be sold, and et cetera? And so how do we efficiently integrate it into new building design? So all of those challenges are being met by different initiatives and so on and so on. What we try to do is bring all that information together, learn as much as we can. It's a hard task because there's so much information out there, so many great initiatives, and then bring that together to create a functioning value chain.
And am I right in understanding it so that efficient exchange of data between the different actors is a key part of
it? It's a major part of it. It is, if we, on the time we have left to solve some of our big issues in regarding the climate change, it is a matter of bringing more people on board. It's a big challenge due to also the lack of competences within this specialty. So what we have to do is actually bring the companies that work in different parts of the value chain closer together by use of technology, and that comes down to selecting, if you like to bring it more simply, if you are registering a building, you can reduce the amount of choices that you need to make by a factor of 10 by creating a simple workflow on an app, maybe. And then having using of public information to actually make the registration process faster. Because otherwise, it would today a big office building might require $250,000 to register, right? And if we want to scale the registration of reusable components, materials, that might be a bit too expensive.
Sure.
Right. So those type of examples.
Okay. Yeah. That makes sense. So this is registering existing buildings that are out there so we can think about upcycling, know what to do with our assets. Maybe this question of data is a little bit of a nebulous concept. So Jarl, you guys are obviously working quite a bit on this and you touched on it in your talk. Could you please explain what sort of value it gives you guys to be able to have that sort of full transparency on the workflow and utilize the data that you generate through all the different steps?
Well, to us, we started ground up being digital. So we had a digital approach. So the idea of digitizing an existing company is quite cumbersome. So we had the luxury of starting from scratch. So having done that, we can now harvest all the fruits, so to speak, by having these digital twins. So the ability to know exactly what is what in a building, to me, is some of the core stepping stones, is actually in having value retention in all the parts. And value retention, to me, is a key factor in sustainability, but also in optimizing buildings and also understanding the cost structure. So sustainability, at least from the start, may cost a little bit more upfront, but if you're in the business of running a building in time, well, you harvest that extra quality you pay for upfront. So I think in order to really have circularity working at scale, we need to adapt these digital tools to produce and manufacture buildings. It's very, very important.
Okay, so if I could turn to you then, Nils. Digital twins, these passports that come with everything, is that valuable for you? Is that something that you can see you utilizing as a developer and potential owner?
Yeah, of course it is. We on all our building sites where there are existing buildings, we track what materials there are so we can reuse them. But we have the problem of strength in certain materials and how long will it last, and so forth. But we have spent the $250,000 to register them. This is important, and it's we're looking very much forward to going to seeing the wear and tear on the furniture from Stuka, and not only that, but all new materials that we are introducing will we're confronting our constructors with the need to map the building. Mm-hmm. But that's going forward is the difficult, the historical buildings, what do we do? How can we reuse them to save the carbon that's already stored there?
So it's about creating more transparency around the decision-making. So we heard from your scene that we're probably going to be seeing more parameters coming into financial decision-making. And in order to make efficient decisions around these parameters, we need that transparency that the data can bring.
Yeah, and we need it across the sector. It's not we need like Hode Labs. It's very much single companies that are doing it in Denmark, at least currently. So everybody's hiding their data from each other, and we need to share this in order to move forward.
So it's not just a question of building up that data, building up the knowledge, but finding new ways of combining it and bringing it out. You've seen, I would like to bring you in into this discussion then. You have been working with developing reporting and different types of metrics and tools around more sustainable real estate finance and investment. So I'd like to ask you a little bit about this, these questions of data and transparency and being able to bring different types of data together. How are you seeing that in this sort of wave towards maybe more conscious investments? Is that something that plays a part, and are you seeing some of the same challenges maybe? Oh, you're seeing, I believe your mic is off. Please go ahead.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you.
Ah, good. So data is a great servant, but it's not a great master. So data, as I see data, and the way we've been working it when my former job at GRESB, data was really the thing that helped the relationship flourish. But what is so material is that relationship, in this case, between investor and manager. So the investor is the asset owner, is the allocator of money. The manager is the guy on the ground looking after building the houses or, you know, having a standing investments. But the relationship between manager and investor is so material. And if that material relationships gets infused with good data, then that relationship itself can really start helping to do the right thing on the ground. So what I like to look at it almost like a tree, you know, or some ecological structure. Information flows from one to the other, But it's the relationship itself that is going to help us turn things around and do that at scale and in time. So yeah, data is a great tool, but it's not what it's in the end about. It's about actually the guys on the ground doing the right thing and getting good input from the guys on the top, in this case the investors, telling them we need to do better.
So it's the same thing we have been talking about. It's sharing of the data. It's the way the data can establish new relationships and put more information into relationships. So
maybe one thing, Carl, if I may just add, because one thing, what I find so fascinating, and that's why it's so important what's happening in the real estate sector, especially in the real asset side, so real estate and infrastructure, and arguably also our agriculture and forestry, but in the real asset side of the market, this chain of command is much more, because these are long-term illiquid assets, this chain of command is shorter and therefore can really start showing results. So we're a lot further away from this type of approach, say in equities, and even further away in fixed income if we look at the financial world. So what's happening in the real estate side of things is actually a prequel to what's going to happen in the rest of the economy, I hope.
Could you elaborate on this this notion of the chain of command being shorter? What do you mean there?
Yeah, in real assets, and probably Niels can talk about it, real assets are typically illiquid holdings for institutional investors, you know, so they hold it for a relatively long time, and therefore they build up a longer term relationship with the manager who's looking after those assets. So it's if you compare it to equities, where you buy something today and you sell it tomorrow, there the chain of command is much more diffuse. Here it's a stronger relationship, and therefore more innovation and creativity and especially collaboration can take place
within that relationship. Okay, yeah. So that would naturally bring us to you, Niels, and. The question is not just if you recognize that relationship, I imagine you might do, but is that a relationship that comes with obligations? Are you seeing more and more pressure, for example, coming into that relationship from your investors, from your constituents in the pension fund?
Well, I can recognize the relationship, and I think another point is that we own many real estate assets, which means that if we learn something on one asset, we can transfer it to other assets. This means that if we have the learning curve is much steeper, and we can learn lots from each individual asset that we can bring together and generate a lot of value from the knowledge. Yes, we are seeing a lot of pressure from our investors and from our members, but we are driven to do this. Back to capitalism, everybody is doing it. So if we don't do it, we will have fewer to buy our properties in the end, which means it's a lower price ultimately. So we are seeing both a market drive and a constituent drive.
And just to be very specific here, this market drive is towards more sustainable buildings, more circular buildings as well.
Yeah. Both and carbon right buildings, and we're working, and we believe this pressure will only increase. So we need to be on top of the game. So we will get a higher price for a certified building with a gold standard or platinum standard 2020 than we will have for a gold standard 2018. So we need to be, if we are ahead of our game, we will have a better price in the end. If we push the environmental and green in our buildings.
So it is part of the business case. We have questions from the audience. So Pernille, please, would you?
Yeah, we have a few. We have one to Stücker, which I'll raise a little bit later in the debate. But just following into Josine and Nils's comments, we have from Christian Koch saying, so remembering the theme of the day in terms of accelerating the transition, I'm worried about a quality trap, i.e. to show that solutions can work in one project is not enough. So what does the panel think about public regulation to promote circularity and in particular public regulation of financing of innovation in a circular direction. And that is actually a beautiful link into Jewel Mass, who's asking, we can't expect companies to make sustainable solutions viable when the economy does not price carbon. Which role does government have in ensuring the economy is getting realistic price signals?
Okay. Sine, do you want to start with these questions here?
Yeah, I mean, it is. I'd say it's a bit of the elephant in the room. Huh? We, as long as we indeed don't price carbon, and we have a still a mono variable structure whereby we actually we calculate everything back to money, we are in dire. That's why we're in the problems that we're in. Huh? The charts that Yael showed are absolutely true. We're over 400 particles per million of greenhouse gases in our atmosphere. We should never have gone beyond the 360. So indeed, we are. I mean, what I'm hoping, and you know, that's the best I can do here, is that everybody, the investors, the managers, the creative people, the IT people, as everybody's waking up at the same time. Also, the regulator will step in more forcefully. But up to now, it's been much more on the transparency side. If you look at the EU, the EU taxonomy and the EU regulation, it's been start making sure that you know what you're emitting, but it's not yet been, you know, let's regulate it, let's start limiting it. So indeed, the regulator, yeah, we need better legislation, and we're not yet getting it. So in the meantime, let's get ready for doing everything we can. But I share also the worry.
So maybe this is a good segue into to this elephant in the room, the carbon and the price on carbon discussion. So in Denmark, we will have new limits coming in into place for carbon in new buildings above 1,000 square meters. These will be coming into effect in 2023, and then they'll be progressively tightened. So I would like to maybe ask you first, Niels, will these regulations come in, will they have a big effect on you in Pension Denmark? Is this something you're actively working to meet, or is this already sort of covered by what you've been telling us here before?
Of course, we are always meeting current regulations.
Sure.
But sure, yeah. Well, we are working hard to making sure that we in all our projects will meet the standard, and we're trying to push it even further that we can. But we need a tool. We have developed our own crude tool to measure carbon, and it's still difficult to measure carbon exactly, and in new buildings what comes in and so forth. So. I think it's we need a standard in the industry for exactly how to do it, but of course it will have a major impact for us.
So it's not just a question of regulation, but it's also a question of having the frameworks that make the regulation efficient and applicable. And
yeah, we need some kind of baseline.
A baseline. Okay. With this question of carbon and how to measure carbon, Rolf. You sort of given us a little bit of a sneak peek behind the scenes and how you're doing. Sorry, Yael first and then Rolf. But you're giving us a little bit of a sneak peek, Yael, in how you're doing this in Stuka. Could you talk a little bit more about how you're approaching this question of carbon and some of the challenges you had to face in terms of actually making these calculations and coming out with numbers on your products?
Yeah, first of all, to me personally, I think that this is one of the keys we need to solve. There are two ways. One is a legislative approach, where we need politicians to tighten rules and make carbon taxes. That takes a bit of time because it's painful and it's going to hurt, but it needs to be done. But it takes time. So in the meantime, we're hell-bent on showing that sustainable can actually perform or outperform polluting alternatives. And this is why to us, showing and being transparent about everything we do is key, because we need to be copied. We need, first of all, to show it's good business, because then things will happen, pure market-driven approach. But also, we need to be copied by the whole industry. Everybody needs to be doing this. But it, of course, it takes a bit of work.
Are you sharing your approach with the industry? Are you making it so that this can be copied?
We're actually planning on open sourcing all our hardware because we need to be copying it in order for this to work.
Okay, so Rolf, this question of carbon and the mm-hmm. carbon load of construction, this is of course a key question in the Circular Bank project that you guys are heading up. So I'd like you to maybe speak a little bit to that link between the circular economy and carbon in construction and what you're trying to do there to try and bring these together and maybe minimize the carbon load of the environment.
Yeah. So one of the key issues in that in the Circle Bank project is actually coming up with a trustworthy paradigm for LCA calculations that work both at an early state in the project. So how do we estimate something where we know very little, right? So that's one of the contributions, and also coming up with contributing to the work that's being done on scaling the EPDs that we have on our building products. And also linking back to Christian Koch's great question, I think one of the areas that I see as a bigger challenge than all the digital work that we participate in is actually coming up with a fast and efficient way of allowing designers to reuse existing building materials. I would put a lot of emphasis on that in terms of investments from the public, and also a key area to look into when it comes to legislation, because it is when we look at the components and the materials we can reuse right now, there are a few examples that can compete with virgin products, but it's not very many. So I think as we wait patiently for the CO2 taxation, I think that's also a key area we can invest into and actually bring some bring down some of the barriers that we see in can we actually just reuse this component, right? So that's a link to that question.
So upcycling of construction and demolition waste, or rather building components before they turn into waste, is sort of a key link there to be able to meet the carbon demands that we are getting in.
Yes, because I don't see the big challenges being in the integration of everything. It's not a technological difficult exercise. It's the difficult exercise is legislation and the certifications and all the stuff around it. So we're kind of gonna make the integrations, I'm sure. But it's all the effort around it. So it was a really good question. It's a really good area to focus on.
Yael, you had a comment here?
Yeah, we're trying to make actual carbon sequestering predictions, but also carbon emission predictions for our full value chain. And that takes a ton of time. We're doing it because it's a part of our core mission, but I could just, like, this process to any company is a huge and difficult task. So I think that there could be some ways in making tools that help companies actually approach this in like in a simpler way. This could also be a pretty interesting solution too. To help out with this stuff, if you want to try it out,
it's actually a great. If I can link to that, we just with the current technology, we see that the this might be a Danish specific case, but at least kind of the integration of new designs and rapidly answering what the consequences are of different design choices is something we could reduce from maybe a few work weeks to a few seconds. Right, we can do that right now. But we haven't scaled it yet. So I think the solutions are out there for some of these aspects, estimating, quantifying carbon. And there has been investments in this side, and it is. I think that's going to see its effect in the years to come. So I think the real challenge is in the legislation of some of the problems around it. Yeah.
I just want to say also that we don't have to wait on this tool to be developed. We can start right now. And it's important that we start right now so that we and then develop the tool alongside it so that we use a crude model and then work from there. It's because we need to get started now. So this discussion about, is everything in place that I started? I know, but still we need to get going. So let's start with a crude model and work from there.
And through working with the model, hopefully also refine it.
Exactly.
I'd like to, so this question of legislation and the price on carbon is another question I'd like to just return to. We are seeing, I work for a architecture and research company. We're working in London with certain a number of clients there. And we can see that there's a great focus on carbon and bringing down carbon. And this focus is coming from the market with some push from policy and legislation as well. So I'm wondering if the market is actually really moving fast here with an expectation that these things are going to change, maybe even faster than the legislation. Are you seeing a situation where we can imagine tenants, occupiers move to a building with a lower carbon footprint, for example? Do you think that is still sci-fi, or is that something that's very much on the horizon?
I know that's happening. So the tenants indeed are asking for, you know, cool, good buildings looking well and also with a very low footprint, because that reflects well on them. So I'm seeing that pressure indeed building up from a lot of different points. I'm personally still most interested in the flow of money, so the institutional investors investing with the managers. And one of the things I find very fascinating, but maybe it's just me, is that the whole construct of capitalism was set up based on limited liability. So you put in some money and you cannot get, you know, you can't get lose more money than the money that you put in. That's the basic. It started 200 years ago in the Netherlands with the VOC. But what I'm seeing now is that we're going from limited liability for these institutional investors towards an extended responsibility. So all of a sudden, their whole portfolio is becoming their responsibility. What is happening with that money? Where is it flowing? How are people doing? How much waste are we producing? How much carbon are we emitting? How much water are we using? You know, it's becoming a real responsibility to first of all know the environmental impacts that you're having, and then to reduce them. So we are, and it's been said, I really like that quote, you know, we're not in an era of change, but we're in a change of era. Things are really, really changing very, very fast with the help of technology, with the help of people being incredibly creative and, you know, collaborative. I mean, I love the whole idea of y'all saying we need to be copied. I mean, that's, you know, that's very advanced thinking to think in that way. So indeed, we all need to do things differently, and we still have some time, apparently. So that's the good news.
Some time left. We also have some time here. We have time for questions from the audience.
Yes, and I just thought maybe this is, as Josine is also mentioning, Jarl, just to read, to remember to mention the question to Stücker, because we have from Christian Thusen from DTU the question: how will you ensure your solutions are relevant and backward compatible over time? After all, we change our kitchen every 10 years, as you say. But just getting back to the legislation, because I have some questions to Josine in terms of legislation. In Denmark and probably also elsewhere, companies finance their investments mostly by internal finances. Won't that hamper the EU taxonomy law that regulate through the banks? Following up with that, currently Danish companies have more money in their bank accounts than they loan from the banks. A bit unusual, but again, weakens the impact of financial legislation.
Yeah, it's a good one. I had never really thought so much about that. I'm very much on that money flow side. That's where my working life has been. And it is true that the EU is focusing on that as well. So what the person is saying, that because companies are so cash rich, I mean, they won't need either institutional investors or the banks to do what they want to do. I mean, if that is so, then the legislation will come straight to the companies, right? So it's currently using the money flow as one of the main levers for legislation, but I'm sure that legislation will come further towards them as well. And it is. I mean, we're seeing actually some very strange legislation on the real estate side. The Netherlands now, you're not allowed to sublet a building with less than a C level, huh? After 2023, I think it is. So that's actually, you know, atrocious legislation, because it's based on these levels. It's not based on actual emitted carbon, which data is already available. So you're seeing legislation. I don't know actually the way that Denmark is putting it into place, but you're seeing some legislation coming a bit, you know, piecemeal, not a structured approach, and that can actually do a lot of harm for our economy and for ourselves. So yeah, it's going to be a little bit messy, and legislation that does not work through the financial side will come to the corporates themselves.
Okay, Jarl, there was a question for you about backwards compatibility.
Yeah, from Christian, an amazingly good question. Thank you, Christian. Well, actually, this is one of the key things. You need every product to stay relevant. Otherwise, it kind of loses its point and it turns into trash. So we need to do a multitude of things. So starting from the sub-suppliers, we spent a great deal of efforts looking into patents for each part we use. So when they run out of patent, we can always replicate them. Remanufacture, but also the large hardware manufacturers we use for rails, for kitchens, for example, we actually have a 50-year design license where they commit to being able to supply these parts. So obviously we choose the largest vendors possible and so on. So it's one of the core things. And on top of that, you have the digital twin principle. So in every apartment, no matter if you versioned the product, you always save that exact geometric model of the product. So you actually will always have that, and that will be open source, you can always access it. So in 15 years time, even if we're not here, the files will be on a server somewhere and you can link it via the codes on the product. So you would yourself be able to take your drawings and continually develop your own product. So those are some of the thoughts we put into this. It's a really, really good question.
That temporal perspective is of course one of the key challenges with the circular economy in the built environment, exactly because assets are around for so long as they are. So yep. Figuring out what models we can use to maintain not just data, but the agreements and the different things that set into place is a challenge. Maybe that falls in under this notion that we're moving from a situation of limited liability as a core principle for business to one of extended responsibility. I would like to ask you, Nils, this notion of extended responsibility, what does that mean from where you're sitting, and what sort of challenges does it bring with it for you as an organization?
We very much recognize it, and we don't shy away from it. But of course, it gives us challenges in how we communicate and our approach, and we will have many people saying we're doing greenwashing, or we're not doing it right, or we should be further ahead, and so forth. But it needs we need to be diligent in everything we do. So we're taking everything serious and having a process for everything, and having documentation for everything. That's important for us. But I think, at least in our real estate department, we have learned that making this diligence, making the processes of doing things environmentally sound, have challenged us to how we view buildings and made us smarter and made better solutions for our tenants as well. So I think for us combined, we've challenged ourselves not only on the green side, but on the combined building, which means that we actually deliver a better product. So I think it's just on that side alone, it's just been not a challenge, but a reward to us. But there are challenges, of course, there are.
And could you elaborate? So you said you maybe changed the way you look at your building or your assets. Could you elaborate a little bit about that change?
Yeah, well, we meet many different contractors on many different levels in a different process towards making certifications of the buildings, and we can compare the different office buildings, the different residential buildings to one another, see the progress that different developers are doing, giving information to different developers, challenging all our consultants in can they use less concrete in the supporting structure? Some say they can, some say they can't. So then we challenge those who say they can't. So it's this: we have this challenge, and we also maximizing spaces and doing more to, like we spoke of earlier, working on different levels of making the investment sound and stable for the long term.
So there's a series of interconnected challenges, yeah. Really. I would like to, we just heard from Nils about some of the challenges. I would like to make a lightning round, I think, and ask you all in a second to name or think about, talk about what you think is the key challenges that we are facing, or from where you're sitting, you are facing in terms of scaling up the approaches from circular economy. And maybe if I can start with you, Jarl, put you on the spot. What is the key challenge that you guys are looking at in terms of moving on and scaling your approach?
Well, one of our core consumables is wood. So we're very much looking into the supply chain and figuring out how do we solve this at scale, because I think wood will take place of concrete in the very near future. We will see a huge uptake, so we need to be very diligent about how we scale and convert the way we have used our lands to better, do better forestry. I think this is going to be one of the key challenges.
Okay. Yossine, can I turn to you? What do you see as one of the key challenges from where you're sitting moving forward in terms of scaling the circular economy, some of the approaches we've been talking about?
Yeah, in spite of the fact that Pension Denmark is here, which is really great, I really do see that the investor attention is lacking for especially the embodied carbon and the waste of developers' waste. There's a huge amount of attention on operational carbon right now in the real estate sector, but for circular you actually need other attention points. So it's again, it's almost like we're adding operational carbon as the very important variable, but we don't see that there are a couple of extra variables that also need to come into that equation. So I'm a bit worried that we're just going to have two variables, money and carbon, and then it will be mostly our operational carbon, unfortunately.
Okay. And Jarl, from where are you sitting? Sorry.
Well, I want to link back to, I was kind of touching on this subject a little while ago. So staying in that kind of realm of making it easier to reuse these components and materials is actually one of the key challenges. Even though I work with the technology and the data integration side of things, that's what I see. And to elaborate a little bit, is the entire industry is going to have to need someone who can process these some of the components. Some of them can be reused one-to-one, some of them can't. Some has to go through different journeys in life. This entire change in our industry is one of the key challenges, apart from what the rest of the panel is saying, which I obviously agree to. But that is especially one that I see on a kind of on a practical level, just having someone to say, well, I want to reuse this, can I? And even maybe I have a big enough portfolio to reuse it myself, but if I want to sell it, what about the liability for that with those products and so on and so on? So we need the entire apparatus behind this way of thinking to scale, and that is something that takes my breath away, I think.
Okay, so if I can try and sum up then, we've heard a lot about some of the great technical solutions that are out there. We've heard about the value of being able to control your own production, your design to fabrication value chain, the way that you can optimize and bring in more quality. Start thinking about how to bring down prices by being more transparent for yourself and for your suppliers in terms of what you're trying to do. We've heard something about the value of this for developers, the value it brings to be able to maybe also start thinking about the assets in a bit of a different way, thinking about a more long-term relationship with the asset itself, with some of the relationships around it, the users, and think about how the uses of the asset impact the value. We also heard, I think, very interestingly from Yossine that there's a move now in the financial markets towards looking at more variables, towards thinking about carbon, hopefully more than just operational carbon, also embodied carbon. Maybe also thinking about aspects such as longevity, some of the risks that potentially come with this, water and so on. But there's still challenges. There's challenges with the supply chain, with figuring out how to adequately map the supply chain and thinking about some of the land use patterns if you want to really change the way the materials we're using. And a lot of challenges around sort of figuring out the relationships that these new ways of driving value is really requiring, whether that is sharing data, whether that is new relationships between developers and contractors, building operators, and so on. And finally, of course, we do have a challenge with the materials that are already out there, with the built environment as it is, and what we can use for them moving forward. I hope this sums up. This was a very wide-ranging talk. It's been great getting you guys' perspective. If you have any last questions out there, I think this is it. Now we should get them on.
Yeah, because here comes the tough question, and it's Nils, you clearly represent the good guys in the industry. And after Kåre's beautiful sum up, what do you suggest we do with the bad guys?
Well, we need legislation, of course, to push them in the right way. I think one of the challenges going forward is accepting that we are on different levels. That's one of the problems with the EU's taxonomy as well. How do we incorporate the whole of Europe on different levels, different climate zones? And we need to see investors as well as being on different levels. We are pushing contractors in the right way so they can easily and know how to supply the right product. And I think the bad guys, well, they will learn the hard way. They will not get the same return for the investments in the end. So it's a blunt move not to move in the environmental right way.
That was a good answer and a hopeful answer, I think, to maybe end on. I think that notion of recognizing we are on different levels, that this is not a all or nothing transition that we're doing here, that we don't have to wait for the perfect framework to be developed, the perfect carbon tool is great in order for moving forward. So hopefully that and this talk and this debate can inspire a lot of the people out there. Thank you so much for hanging on, and thank you, of course, to our great panel. We've had over here, all the way from Holland, Jussien Pick, who is a partner in Haven Green Capital Partners. We've had Jarl Engelbrink Bindes, founder and CEO of Stücke. We've had Rolf Buchmann Slorup, who is managing director and chief operating officer of HT Lab. And we've had Nils Christian Jone, head of transactions at Pension Denmark. My name is Kåre Poulsgaard. I'm from GXN, and I've been delighted to be able to host this debate along with BLOXHUB. Thank you all.